The biggest issue seems to be RE. Given that the chief executive and leader are both all members of RE, why weren't they aware of these issues?
Mr. Dix, I don't think that the supplementary relates to the difference between the quarter three outturn and the final position, because we've made it very clear that the information that the report that we received last at the Performance and Contract Management Committee was based on quarter three information, and that the outturn clearly had all the quarter four information. The quarter four information had the new Section 151 officer looking at a large number of issues, and as a result of that, a number of judgments were made which resulted in the changes that were made. So that, I think, is the answer that we can give.
With regards to the answer's question, so first of all, I'm pleased that the council does admit that the current position is unsustainable. My concern is when you say you're putting in place actions to avoid such a drawdown in the future, are the plans to do this for being drawn up by the same people as who got us into this mess in the first place? Because generally, I mean, I work in business, I've worked for large organisations and small organisations, and I run my own company. When you work for a large organisation, which I think Barnet is, when something goes catastrophically wrong, typically it gets wrong, and you bring new people in to sort the mess out. Is there any plan to do that?
Mr. Sitchman, the council officers are working on resolving the position that has been drawn to the attention of Policy and Resources, and that will be debated at the Policy and Resources Committee later in the month.
Sorry.
Mr. Goodman.
What?
I'm not sure if that was an answer.
Right, Mr. Dix. That's
it?
Question number five.
We talk about these recovery plans being put in place to address both these and other issues identified. Slightly entertaining about the answer is, I said, at what point did they identify the crisis and start working to mitigate the pressures? So some of the pressures were known and predicted throughout last year, but you don't say when work started on mitigating them, which is really the crux of the question. So could you answer when the work started on mitigating them with a few dates, please?
Well, I would say that there was some mitigation work going on before the significant change that we've all been talking about. But if you ask me when were significant and precise actions started, they were early in this financial year, so May time.
After the election.
Mr. Dix.
My supplementary is, what do you mean by enhanced scrutiny and who will undertake it?
Mr.
Number six.
Number 11.
is not appropriate to this committee, so I'll leave there.
Thank you. And Mr. Dix, number 12.
Our supplementary is, it may be clear to you, but it's not clear to me. And I'm sure that it's not clear to many people, but table 2 is saying he's overspent by nearly £7 million compared to the forecast variation in Q3 of just £285,000. So I'm asking, are all committee members as clear about table 2 or the same as you?
That's the difference between the two reports, and it's quite striking. Mr. Dix, I think that we have attempted to, not claiming that this is completely straightforward, and I'm not claiming that this is the only possible way of presenting the data. What I would say is that we have attempted to actually do a comparison between the quarters, which in a very careful way, which has not been done in this way before, and this right up front in the report. We've got later in the paper, which you've made comments on, a suggestion for Chief Financial Officer's report on the Council's financial affairs, and clearly trend data, as you identify later, is going to be important. And understanding variances and movements in variances is going to be important. So I take the point that it may be possible to improve the presentation, but I believe that we are now at least presenting the information in a way that it is possible to do the analysis, whereas I think in the past it has been very difficult to do the analysis.
I'd like to make some much comment to Mr. Dix, if I could. Table 2 was an attempt, as it has worked, I apologise for that, but it was an attempt to show what was reported in quarter 3, which is the middle column, what is reported in outturn, and the difference between 3 and 4, because the thrust of a number of your questions is what happened between 3 and 4. And there's an attempt to do that, so the increase-decrease column has a set of differences between 3 and 4.
I just took the comparison between the two reports. The one that was presented to the Senate on the 27th of February, the one that's in today, through to year end. And that is a very different representation of Table 2. It's much clearer where the difference is occurring, not the other. Okay?
Mr. Dixard, could you give us a copy of that so we can look to see why the difference is occurring?
Number 13, I'll leave that one.
Number 14.
Yeah, who provided the information to the Director of Resources? Was it Green or was it CSG? Or what information was provided? I know it's you, yes, for your time.
Let me give you a partial answer, and then I'll let Section 151 of Steel City give his take on this. I believe that the then Section 151 officer considered the information which was available to her at the time and formed a view. Since that time, legal advice has been received which changed the position, and as a result, the current Section 151 officer concluded differently.
I'll talk about my decision, which I think is entirely appropriate. There was a debtor in the council's accounts for £1.5 million. It's not collectible. We have legal advice to say it's not collectible. There is only one response to that, and that is to write the debt off. And that's a decision. I would like to comment on why it's not collectible, but I've been given advice that it isn't, and that would be my wish to remember what I said.
No, I was going to say that that's the advice.
Okay.
So
that's
it. It comes back to the same problem. The problem is, John Hume and Richard Brookings are all directors of it. I can't believe that they weren't made aware. But if they weren't made aware, that equally is very serious. They should be made aware as board directors of it. But this was an issue. Why did that happen?
I think that you are positing the wrong issue, which is that there was an element that was known about and was discussed, and therefore it was not that they could not have known about it as directors agreed, because at the PCM meeting, those of us that were there will remember the discussion that took place. The new information since last year is that the belief about the characterisation of that £4.5 million was wrong, and legal advice was received, and there's been a change of Section 151 officer during the period, and as a result, that meant that there was a period when the current Section 151 officer was familiarising himself with the council, and when he got to this point, he looked at the position, and the correct decision was taken. And the important thing is that in the accounts that have been prepared that will be going to the Audit Committee, this issue has been correctly dealt with. I don't know whether the Section 151 officer has anything.
Doesn't look very comfortable.
Can I just say one additional point on that, which is that the change in Section 151 officer is not material to the change in position on the income, the material facts with the receiver of the legal advice.
So, my supplement for the next one is, do you regret telling me on the 27th of February the benefit to the council of the additional income of the green contract is guaranteed and does not therefore impact on green? So that claim wasn't true. And my question, my supplementary question is, when did you commission the legal advice on this payment? And when was that legal advice provided?